In 86, my wife got a job on Nantucket Island. I really didn't know much about the place, other than I had read about it in my favorite book, Moby Dick. And so we moved there with our kids, who were 1 and 4, and it was very depressing after a year to discover that Melville had written Moby Dick without ever having visited Nantucket. Such is the power of historical imagination. And I became fascinated with how Nantucket became this place, this whale oil capital of the world, America's first global economic endeavor. And you know, this was not just whale oil, this was pursuing the whale, but it was also explorations, taking these Nantucketers around the world. And Nantucket, this little sandbank of what Melville called Quakers with a vengeance. They were pacifists when it came to the human race, but if you were a sperm whale, you realize they had a very different attitude towards you. And this little island was a quintessential American place. And so I began to write a book called A Way Offshore, which is my first work of history. My kids, I was at home with the kids, so once they went to school, I'd go into the archives of the Nantucket Historical Association, the Athenaeum on Nantucket, which is our library, and the town building. And it really was where I established the method I've been following ever since, trying to create a sense of what life was like in the past by going to the documents. And I rapidly began to realize that for me it was more than going to the documents. And I think it really harkened back to the experience I have had in Asheville. For me, it's very important to go to the places. On Nantucket, I obviously lived on that island, and I really felt as if the history was underneath my feet. And so the research process for me was going to the archives, reading documents from that past, and then going to the specific places, often with my little kids in tow, and just figuring out how it all worked. And it's the mode I have followed ever since. And it's one in which has taken me in many directions. In the Heart of the Sea followed from A Way Offshore. That is, as Susan said, the story of the whale ship Essex. And you know, that is the kernel of reality that inspired the climax of Moby Dick, in which the great white whale rams the Pequod and sinks it at the end. In reality, in 1820, the Essex had a crew of 20, was 1,000 miles to the west of the Galapagos Islands when with the cabin boy, 15-year-old Thomas Nickerson at the helm, when a huge 85-foot sperm whale appears on the side of the ship, just sitting there, which was an unusual behavior for an 85-foot bull sperm whale, the biggest any of them had ever seen. Usually they fled in panic from a whale ship, but this whale was slightly different. It was just sitting there, but no one was particularly concerned because whales had never in the history of American whaling ever attacked a whale ship. This whale began to swim towards the ship, dove down, and then when it surfaced, it was now going at least 3 knots, building to 6 knots, and bam! Its block-like head slammed into the side of the Essex, knocked all the men off their feet. The whale went underneath the ship, surfacing so the ship was going up and down as if in the midst of an earthquake. And then this huge whale, as long as the ship itself, knocked out, appeared on the starboard side, head towards the bow, tail towards the stern. It was so close that the first mate, Owen Chase, took the killing spear, an 18-foot lance, and was tempted to try to kill this whale that had dared to attack a ship. But he noticed that the tail was within feet of the rudder. They were more than 3,000 miles off the coast of South America. This was very early in the history of American whaling. They knew nothing about the islands to their west. He just didn't dare risk that rudder. As Thomas Nickerson, that 15-year-old cabin boy, would say, would write many years later, if Chase knew it was going to happen next, he would have risked that rudder. Because this huge whale springs to life, is now a very angry sperm whale, swims to leeward of the ship, does a behavior typical of an infuriated bull sperm whale, snapping its jaws with a percussive force that could be heard for miles. And then it took off, swam several hundred yards ahead of the ship, turned around, and came directly for the bow of the Essex. Its tail alone was 20 feet wide, going up and down, pushing this whale to at least 6 knots, maybe even more, as this block-like head slammed into the bow of the ship, crushing it like an eggshell, and even according to one account, driving it backwards. The whale pulled its head out from the fractured timbers of the bow and swam off, never to be heard from again. The Essex would begin to sink. The men began to prepare a spare whale boat. The other two, two-thirds of the crew were off whaling. And by the ship began to sink at the bow, and as it was beginning to roll over, they had the whale boat, just 25 feet long, an open, double-ended craft. They took it to the side, they rowed off, and the ship capsized and lay there on the surface of the sea. What to do? What would unfold? And so where the story of the Essex, that's really where the story begins of the Essex, and that's the end of Moby Dick. And